The issue that I'd like to address is resilience. Michael Peck talked about sustainability earlier when he started this session. But a very important component of sustainability is resilience. And the notion of resilience has been around for more than 15 years now. And there are many definitions of resilience that are floating around. The one that I particularly like basically says that our cities, our environment, is going to be subjected repeatedly over our lifetime and in the future by various types of stressors. They can be short-term stressors or long-term stressors. And I will come back to the definition of short-term and long-term stressors. The ability for a city to rebuild itself after a stressor makes that city a resilient city or resilient urban system. What are the short-term and what are the long-term stressors? Short-term stressors are extreme events, whether natural or man-made, such as earthquakes, hurricanes, tornadoes, fires. We're particularly worried right now about fires in California. Long-term stressors can be climate change, as an example. Our cities, our environment, we need to adapt our urban cities to urban environments to such changes so that they can rebuild themselves and come back to an environment that was either at least as good as it was before the event, hopefully better. In fact, it can be used as that extreme event can be used as an opportunity to improve the conditions of the urban environment from before the event. But that improvement or that rebuilding has to be done within a short period of time. This is Kobe earthquake in 1995. That resulted in more than $100 billion in losses. It literally destroyed the entire city. High rises were destroyed just as much as individual homes. This is what Kobe looks today. Japan was able to rebuild the city in a very short period of time. So resilience implies two things. It's not only rebuilding, but rebuilding within a reasonable amount of time. In contrast, New Orleans has never gotten back to its original conditions, whether economic or social or infrastructure. Which brings me to the next issue. National Academy put this particular slide together that shows that resilience requires that first we try to reduce the amount of distress or loss after the event, and then we try to rebuild as quickly as possible. If we take longer, our city is not very resilient. This is for short-term resilience. For long-term resilience, such as climate change, those changes take place gradually, and we need to be planning and incorporating those changes along the way and implementing them in our infrastructure to be able to meet those changes so that they don't impose a stress over time. As I said, bringing back the civil infrastructure to its original position is only one small portion of the overall picture. I just came back recently from Japan, and they were talking about the Tohoku earthquake that was followed by the major tsunami. And they were able to move entire communities. They built housing for entire communities. But the communities never really recovered because families were dislocated and put in different areas. The social fabric was not preserved. So resilience involves more than just rebuilding the civil infrastructure. It is rebuilding the economy, it is rebuilding the social fabric, it is rebuilding the health and wellness of individuals, it is preserving the political system. In fact, through my experience with earthquakes, we know of governments being toppled down together with earthquakes. So the political component is very important, especially for parts of the world that do not have very stable governments. So the political part is very, very important. On this slide, it comes from the Rockefeller Foundation initiative on 100 resilient cities. I know it's very difficult to follow. It is a very busy slide. But it would basically what it says is that we need leadership and strategy from our political leaders. We need to be able to bring our cities to the health and wellness, well-being. We need, of course, to repair our infrastructure, because without our infrastructure, our cities cannot function. And this is not just buildings, but we're talking about the transportation, communication, water, power, sewer, all of the lifelines need to be brought back and function in unison. And of course, the economy is society, the economic well-being and the social well-being of the urban system needs to be brought back. Most of the presentations this morning focused on developing data, generating data, so that we are able to build digital cities. And what I've seen is a very large focus on visual data, imaging data. But we need to go beyond image data. We need data on our social environment, on our economic environment, on the political environment. We need data on all of these components together with our physical infrastructure data. Our cities do not survive only because they have buildings. In fact, I believe it is in China, there are quite a few buildings that are sitting empty, because there is no social fabric, there is no social environment around it. So if you are going to be developing digital city, please remember that you need to develop a digital component for the social, economic, and political part of the city. And with that, I will stop. Thank you.